Hair strands or earlobes? A character already known to be on Onigashima, or one we didn't even know was connected to Wano? Who is the mystery figure teased at the end of chapter 1004? Hello, my Nakamatachi, this is Joy Girl, and today we're going to discuss the mystery of the last panel in the last chapter. Yes, I know this is something that we've discussed in the last chapter review, but because I'm always quite wary of the length of the reviews, and there was already a lot which happened in the last chapter, I don't always get to voice all of my speculations in full detail. And considering the amount of varying candidates we have, I think it's worth a closer look. So I asked you all who you thought was this mystery character. And some of your answers, alongside other popular candidates I've come across in the wider One Piece community, is... well, I gotta say, some sound quite mind-boggling, and some I myself would never have thought of, mainly because in my opinion, they just wouldn't make sense story-wise. Which is why we're here today, to examine such candidates and perhaps discuss and provide reasoning as to how even the most unlikely of candidates could make sense being this mystery figure, or at least attempt to. So, some of this may sound ridiculous and wild, but hey, that's always fun. But before we begin, I do want to celebrate the fact that we have now reached the magic number. After very recently matching the number of Luffy's Grand Fleet, we have now arrived at his special number, Gomu Gomu, and now passed that too. So welcome to all of you who are new here, and thank you to everyone in helping our channel reach this milestone. There is a particular video I wanted to release when we reached this occasion, and so now that we have, you will all see said video soon. And so for all of you who are still not yet subscribed to this channel, make sure you do so now and click that notification bell so that you will be notified when this video is out. And whilst all One Piece fans can watch that special video, today's video is only for manga fans, as it concerns chapter 1004 specifically. So for anime-only fans not wishing to be spoiled, please watch some of my other videos and come back to this one at a later date. Now that that's been said, let's get on to discussing the various candidates for the hooded figure who has come to assist the Scabbards. Starting off with... Gin. Just kidding, get out of here. The first real candidate, to me, seems like an equally joke candidate, but I've seen his name pop up multiple times, and so here we are. Enel. Some people claiming the mystery figure is Enel seem to be obviously joking, at least that's what I initially thought, but this may not apply to everyone. So, if you were to take this seriously, then we'd have to say that the greatest factor in his favor would be the part of the silhouette which I immediately considered to be strands of hair, but if looked at differently, could be considered to be part of Enel's elongated earlobes. And maybe it's more a credit to the talented artists in the One Piece community who have produced these drawings of Enel matching the silhouette, but when you look at drawings like this, well, it's hard to dispute that Enel's earlobes certainly does fit this panel. And if we were to further consider the likelihood of Enel showing up, another piece of potential evidence could be Nami's comments in the same chapter. Nami's words that she needs stronger lightning could be foreshadowing that Enel, a character who was heavily influenced by Raijin, who in Japanese mythology is known as literally the god of lightning, may be showing up. Though there is one major issue to this theory, which is why would Enel be here at Wano? He has no relevant connection that we know of, and in fact, the last time we saw him, it was in the cover story where he has settled and established a new empire on the moon. But when put that way, maybe there is a connection after all. Time to put on our tinfoil hat, guys, because we're gonna stretch further than Enel's earlobes. There is a heavy moon motif present in Wano, such as the mark of the crescent moon, which was used as a symbol of the resistance against Orochi and Kaido, the word Zuki, which means moon in Japanese and is in the names of all the major great families of Wano country, or the fact that it is currently a full moon on Onigashima, allowing the Minks to transform into their Sulong forms. Considering this theme of the moon, perhaps Oda had been hinting at Enel's arrival all along. And if we want to stretch his earlobe, sorry, this theory, even further, we should also consider the Mitsudomoe symbol that is drawn on his drums. This symbol in Japanese culture has been associated with the god of war and samurais. War and samurai, which aptly connects with the current situation at Wano, but there is even a further connection. This Mitsudomoe symbol has actually been seen in the Wano arc, such as on the kimono worn by Cho, the Yakuza boss of Ringo. So there does seem to be a lot to connect Enel to Wano, but as to why he would show up? As we know, Enel learned something about the history of how some races originated from the moon. Maybe this is linked to the secrets contained at Wano about the Void Century. He could be a figure who not only assists the Scabbards, but also sheds light on some of the remaining mysteries left in this arc. But like I said, this is a bit of a stretch. And moving on from one stretchy earlobe to another, we have Fukuro Kuju. The reason for the captain of the former Orochi Onyo Banshu being listed as a possible candidate is likely based on the same reason as Enel, his long earlobes. Though Fukuro Kuju's earlobes are shorter than Enel's, and I would argue also thicker, thereby making it even less likely that these strands shown in the last panel are Fukuro Kuju's ears. On the other hand, if we were to stick with this candidate for a little longer, we could mention the fact that the last time we saw the ninja captain, he was acting very shady and mysteriously slipped off, thus leaving his current locations unknown, and therefore making it possible that it is Fukuro Kuju who is there in the treasure repository along with the Scabbards. Considering his abilities as a ninja, it's not implausible that even though he wasn't with the Scabbards the last time we saw him, that he has since been able to attain their whereabouts. But this does leave the question of, what is he doing there? Has he decided to switch sides and help the Scabbards? Has he been a secret ally all along? Or is he even a more despicable man than we realized and plans to take out the Scabbards whilst they're down? Whilst I'm on board with Fukuro Kuju turning against Kaido, I don't see him being the candidate in this scenario, especially because whilst his earlobes may fit the panel, we haven't seen a long protruding head, which I imagine would be hard to conceal in this scene. Which brings us to another possible foe rather than an ally, Kanjuro. So the biggest argument against Kanjuro being the candidate is the fact that Bao Huang said that the person is attempting to save the samurai and not a fellow enemy, as well as the fact that Kanjuro is dead, or as we know so far. But I don't think that this necessarily rules him out as a candidate. As we have now become accustomed to by this point, we can't always be so sure of a character's death, and if Kanjuro is revealed to be alive, it would hardly be the most shocking twist. In fact, I made a video discussing the concept of death in One Piece, including Oda's use of the fakeouts, which you may also like to watch following our current discussion. But going back to our current topic, especially if we consider Kanjuro's devil fruit ability, we could suppose that the Kanjuro whom Kiku killed was actually a super realistic drawing of Kanjuro's. Now, whilst I suspect Kanjuro being alive would spur quite a bit of discontent amongst the community, if Oda was to use this plot device again, I wouldn't be completely against it. I was actually hoping to see Kanjuro's redemption in this arc, and so if he was alive, rather than him being an enemy, or even if he first plans on killing the Scabbards, I would like to see him being converted into an ally. I can just imagine a scene where one of the Scabbards would say something like, "Master Odin would still accept you as one of his own, even knowing what you did." And Kanjuro, having never felt like he really belonged or had his own identity, would realize that Odin had always accepted him, and that he belonged to Odin and the group of samurais, resulting in him joining their cause for real. But enough of my headcanon, because whilst I still would like to see that scene play out, I do have my doubts about Kanjuro resurfacing at this moment. His designs just don't match the panel. Apart from his long hair, which maybe could fit the strands shown in the last chapter, the rest of what we have been shown, and admittedly it isn't much, but I just can't see how Kanjuro would fit. So let's discuss another Scabbard, Izo. This one confuses me a lot, because Izo was shown to be with the rest of the Scabbards when they were on the rooftop facing off Kaido. In fact, as recent as chapter 1000, we literally saw him injured along with the rest of his fellow Scabbards. And although it is true that we can't actually see Izo as one of the wounded Scabbards in chapter 1004, Bao Huang does mention that she sees 10 figures. So if Izo is the mystery figure, this leaves us with yet another mystery figure to make up the 10 people. So if you have a way to resolve this web of complications, please do let us know in a comment below on how Izo being the mystery figure would make sense. But in the meantime, moving on to another candidate whom I think based on the recent chapters doesn't make him a likely candidate. But considering the name did pop up, let's discuss Yamato. Considering my initial thoughts that these strands in the silhouette were strands of hair, I can't see how Yamato with his design could fit this description. But personally, I never considered him a viable candidate because we did see him in chapter 1003, where he was still with Momonosuke and Shinobu. Whilst the last time we saw this group before chapter 1003, they were in relative safety, in chapter 1003, it seemed like Yamato had his hands full, potentially fending off some enemies. So unless this was a very deliberate misdirect by Oda, I don't think it's very likely that the cloaked figure is Yamato. And another character with luscious hair, thus making him a possible candidate, Basil Hawkins. It's true, Hawkins' long hair does make it plausible that it is his hair strands shown in the last panel. We haven't seen him since the interrogation of D.S. Drake back in chapter 990, and although he was still acting under Kaido's Beast Pirates the last time we saw him, I have mentioned before, such as in the part 2 of my Wano series video, of the possibility of Hawkins switching sides. However, this doesn't explain how he knew where the scabbards were, and why he has decided to switch sides at this moment. Unless he's still acting as a beast pirate, in which case we would have to ask why he has found it necessary to cloak himself so mysteriously. And there is also another reason why I don't think it is likely that Hawkins is the mystery figure. In fact, this reason actually rules out all of the aforementioned characters. Size. In the panel, the mystery figure is tiny compared to Kinemon. Considering that Kinemon is 298 centimeters tall, or 9'8" in US metrics, I would place the figure to be no taller than 2 meters or 6'5", and that's being generous. But all the candidates that we have discussed so far are taller than 2 meters, and I don't think any of them would look so comparatively small when standing next to a sitting Kinemon. Which leads us to the discussion of far more regular sized humans, but before that, here are some other names mentioned, and although I'm sure most of these aren't serious, some are, and even if they're not, I appreciated all of your responses all the same. Starting with the Gorosei. Too tall. Clone Barry 002. Canon figures only please. Ivankov, Dadan, or Gaban. Intriguing, but I understand why even you have little faith in this possibility, giving them only a 1% chance. Kuina? This would be the most mind-boggling reveal, and I'm not sure how I feel about it. Kokoro? Obviously. Crocodile? Outrageous. Buggy? Okay. Katakuri? Also too tall. Vivi? Well, that sure would resolve two mysteries at once, but I'm not sure I see the connection. Bonnie, again, I don't see her relevance to Wano, or how she escaped Akainu. Yamato's mother, Mamato. Again, this would solve two mysteries we currently have at Wano, and this would certainly be a big twist, but I just don't know if we have much to support this case. And now, for my personal favorite, Joy Girl. Yup, you got me, it's been me all along. I have actually created this entire video as a red herring so that my reveal in the manga will be all the more surprising. Okay, let's get serious. Back to our real discussion, now onto the regular human-sized candidates. Starting with Tenguyama. Tenguyama's height is currently unknown, but without his stilts, he does seem to be of average human height. Also, he has stated before that he is waiting for someone, so perhaps he has come to meet this person at Onigashima, and it is somehow connected to the scabbards. Another intriguing detail is that it was recently revealed that the voice actor for Tenguyama is the same actor for Kazuki Sukiyaki. So is it possible that Tenguyama is the former Wano shogun in disguise who didn't die at all? It would explain the mystery of the Tengu mask, and would be one of the biggest plot twists in the Wano arc, but as wild and fun this theory may be, I am almost certain that this figure is not Tenguyama. Aside from the mystery figure seeming female, there is also the fact that though Tenguyama may fit the height component of the figure's size, he doesn't fit the width component. This figure seems to be on the leaner and slimmer side, which aren't quite the words that come to mind when I think of Tenguyama. So moving on to a slim, average height human, Suru. Suru showing up at Onigashima could be plausible. Whilst her exact height is unknown, in her depictions, she seemed to be close in height to Zoro, who is less than 2 meters tall. Also, Suru being revealed here could serve a purpose in revealing the fate of the inhabitants of the Okobore town, and would fit with what seems to be tears shown in that last panel when we remember that Suru is Kinemon's wife. However, I do think that this would be a rather anticlimactic reveal. Though her bravery in misleading Holden was impressive and heartfelt, I don't think Suru being the mystery figure carries enough impact to have warranted the suspense created in the last chapter. Also, whilst it is very possible that in the ordeal of having to escape her burning town, that Suru's hair has come loose, as we know her currently, Suru doesn't have loose strands of hair, and being the respectable lady that she is, always has her hair nicely tied up in a traditional Shimada hairstyle. There would also be the question of how she arrived at Onigashima, and how she found the scabbards in that vast castle. Although, perhaps one could peg it down to lover's instinct? Anyways, moving on to the next candidate, Robin. So this is an intriguing character who didn't even pop into my mind because, as you will know from my chapter review, I was too busy thinking that Robin was a different mystery character. But Robin, being the cloaked mystery figure, could make sense when we factor in her hair, which also has two strands out on either side of her face, the fact that she was last seen running into the castle, and is also one of the only very few Straw Hats we haven't received an update on recently. Also, the fact that Black Maria was seeking Robin in the last chapter could be foreshadowing that when Black Maria arrives at the treasure repository, she will come face to face with Robin herself. And look, if I get to see a Robin versus Black Maria fight, one way or another, I am more than satisfied. But if it was Robin, I would have to ask why all the big secrecy and suspense of the cloak and the silhouette. Though the Robin versus Black Maria face-off would be epic, the dramatic intensity in which Oda designed this cliffhanger would feel a little odd. Not to mention the fact that I also don't see that Robin would be crying in response to seeing the scabbards that way, although I suppose that there's no confirmation that those droplets were actually tears. But let's move on to the next candidate, Hiyori. Hiyori seems to be the most sensible answer to this question of the mystery figure. Her design fits that of the panel when it comes to the strands. It would make sense that she's crying at seeing the scabbards considering her relationship with them, particularly Denjiro and Kawamatsu. Furthermore, the fact that she was pretending to be Komurasaki, who is now known to be dead, the need for such secrecy and her cloak makes sense. Whilst on one hand, an argument could be made against Hiyori due to the fact that she herself said that she would refrain from seeing the scabbards and her brother before the war. But technically, the war has already begun, and considering the current state of the scabbards, she could hardly be a distraction. In fact, she may actually be the driving force needed for the scabbards to remuster their strength to protect her and Wano. Furthermore, another comment that Hiyori has made in the past is that she expressed her desire to kill Orochi herself. And if we take her words seriously, then it's possible that she sneaked her way onto Onigashima to perform this act. Having Hiyori present at Onigashima would bring all the main characters involved in the story together. Her re-entry into the storyline by bringing her back here would be the best place to do it. Unless, of course, the raid at Onigashima fails and the war moves on to Wano, where she will be relevant there. But if the raid doesn't fail, as Hiyori was introduced to us as a major player early in the Wano arc, to have her sidelined for the entirety of the battle does raise some questions. And considering the likeness between her design and that of the mystery figure, she does seem like a very likely candidate. But this does still beg the questions of how she made her way onto Onigashima and how she even found the scabbards. I wouldn't be surprised if the mystery figure is indeed Hiyori. Like I said, she seems to be the most logical candidate. But in saying that, there is still another character who I am leaning towards most, and one who may provide answers to questions of how this mystery figure arrived at Onigashima and found the room that the scabbards are in. Toki. Most of you will know that I strongly believe that Toki is still alive. And hopefully by now you have all watched my video detailing why and how she may have survived and what Toki's role will be in the future of Wano. This video goes through potential hints such as the mystery figure who was tailing Jinbei and Robin, as well as the figure who was seen speaking to Marco on the ship before they arrived at Onigashima. So, El Demonio 009 actually used this figure on the ship as a case to support Hiyori, that in a similar way as Izzo being shown on the ship prior to his reveal at Wano, Hiyori is being hinted in this chapter but in a way to mislead us and create suspense. But, as per my Toki theory video, the figure shown on the ship has a different kimono design than the one worn by Izo, whom we have seen since. Which makes me think that this person on the ship was definitely not Izo and may have actually been Toki. The striped design is one we have actually seen Toki wear before. And the fact that Toki may have been present on the ship is of even greater significance because if this was Toki on board, then it would actually answer the questions we have had for all of our other candidates. How did this mystery figure know where to find the scabbards? If we quickly recap some of the events at Onigashima, Marco, Neko, and Izo arrived at Onigashima and joined with the rest of the scabbards at the entrance to the castle. If it was indeed Toki on board the ship with this group, then she would have also joined up with the rest of the scabbards. And do you remember who was also there along with the scabbards back then? Trafalgar D. Water Law. Law was the one who transported the scabbards away from the rooftop. Why did he move them to the treasure repository? And how did he know to move them there? What if it's because Law knew Toki would be there? If Toki and Law met previously before they all entered the castle, they could have devised a plan together. It seems way too coincidental that this mystery figure, if they were anyone other than Toki, would have simply been able to find the scabbards in this particular room. And also, with the suspense that Oda has created through this cliffhanger, Toki's reveal would be the most fitting in terms of payoff. It would also make a lot of sense story-wise. I mentioned in my Toki Theory video about all of the unresolved plot lines, such as the contents of Odin's letter or the scar on her leg, which I still think are going to become relevant somewhere in this arc. Maybe the scar itself will become relevant here to help identify this figure. Or maybe this is just me trying to manifest my dreams. But until I'm proved otherwise, I gotta say, I am convinced. Which brings us to the end of today's video. Please leave a comment below with your thoughts on the mystery figure and whether this video changed your mind at all. Don't forget to like and share the video if you enjoyed today's discussion, and please also subscribe because we have plenty of more One Piece discussions heading your way. This is Joy Girl, and I'll see you again soon.